Craig, let's talk about the fallout of interest rate increases by central banks. Specifically, we've been seeing aggressive moves by the Bank of Canada, more so by the Federal Reserve.
Both central banks have recognized and been quite transparent that they now feel that they've fallen behind the curve when it comes to inflation. When inflation started to take off last year, they felt that it was transitory, that what they were seeing was the price effects from the supply chain disruptions that had occurred during the pandemic that had created bottlenecks. But now they've recognized that inflation has gotten so high. A good portion of the inflation is actually coming from the robust demand during the recovery. They're looking at very tight labor markets with businesses across both countries reporting labor shortages. They're seeing wage pressures building, and they have to respond. And because they've fallen behind the curve, they're playing catch up. And that's why they're raising rates by more than they normally would. So instead of the typical quarter point increases in rates, we're seeing, you know, the Bank of Canada lifting rates by half a point, the Federal Reserve being even more aggressive with a 3/4 of a point increase, with them signaling to expect another 3/4 of a point move in July. And this is naturally causing markets to worry about the possibility that this could cause a recession, because markets remember that in the early 70s, early 80s, early 90s, we had high inflation periods. And when central banks rapidly raised interest rates, it triggered a turn in the business cycle.
It seems that not too long ago, though, we were talking about an economic recovery. And if you take a look at those recent retail numbers, they were up in April. Projections coming in for May could be up around 1.6%. However, the GDP numbers, the real GDP numbers, tell a different story. What is your forecast for economic growth?
Well, I think what the activity numbers are showing, like the retail sales numbers you're mentioning, like there's still lots of momentum in the economy. We've seen a very strong recovery during the pandemic. And I think part of the reason for the recovery is the amount of stimulus that governments and central bankers provided. If you think about the amount of stimulus that was provided during the pandemic, it was unprecedented. And in fact, when you look at the situation for consumers, we had a situation where the pandemic caused the biggest economic contraction that we've had since the Great Depression. We had unemployment that increased sharply, and yet household income increased. And the reason that happened was that government transfers to households actually exceeded the loss of labor income due to lost labor compensation. So households were very much insulated to the fallout of the pandemic, and that meant they had the capability to spend. And so as the health risks diminished and there was pent-up demand created during the pandemic, consumers were well positioned to be able to go out and spend as the recovery took place. And so we've had a very strong, very V-shaped recovery, and the strength of that recovery has been so strong that it has contributed to the inflationary pressures that we've seen. So really what we've had is a combination of a supply problem created by the supply chain disruptions created by the pandemic and by the war in Ukraine that caused energy prices to skyrocket. So we've had supply problems, but we've also had really strong demand that has fueled economic growth. And so that's what the economic numbers are showing us. And what's happening is the central bank is now responding with higher interest rates, acting to try and cool the economy. And I think what we're going to see is that the combination of the high rate of inflation that is outpacing the wage growth that consumers are getting, or households are getting, combined with higher debt service costs, are going to lead to a consumer slowdown. I think we're going to see consumer spending moderating. I think we're going to see a correction in Canadian real estate markets. I think housing prices in Canada are going to come down by probably on average more than 10%, and more than 10% in the most unaffordable cities in Canada. as measured by the prices relative to incomes. If you think about it, as interest rates are rising, the mortgage stress tests mean that it's getting harder to qualify for larger mortgages. So a good example is, right now, with a 5% mortgage, you're now getting income tested against your ability to pay a 7% mortgage. And so what that means is that people are not qualifying for as large a mortgage. And so you're going to see the Canadian housing market really cooling down, and that's going to slow down the Canadian economy. Now, the real question is how slow is it going to get? And this is where you get the debate about, are we going to have a recession or are we going to have a significant slowdown in growth? And my personal bet is that a recession isn't guaranteed. I think we're going to see significantly slower growth. I think inflation is probably going to remain elevated. And what we're probably going to get is much weaker growth, but continued elevated inflation. So this is where I think the way we would characterize this is a period of stagflation, right? But if central banks are continue to be very aggressive on interest rates, and let's say, the assumption I've been using is that the Bank of Canada is going to take the overnight rate up to the top end of its estimate of neutral, which is an overnight rate of around 3%. And right now, that means the Bank of Canada raising rates still, another percentage point from where we are, another percentage point from where we are today. That actually, if they go beyond that, significantly beyond that, you start running the risks of a recession. And in the United States, the Fed is being very aggressive, like moving up in three quarters of a percentage point increments is running even bigger risks of creating an interest rate shock. Now, Americans aren't as indebted as Canadians are, so they might be less affected by the degree of the interest rate shock. But if the Fed remains aggressive, if the Fed funds rate gets up to 4% or higher, I think that the risks of a recession become really material. So a lot depends on how high ultimately central banks take rates. The most likely scenario is that once they get rates up to the top end of neutral, so 3%, 3.5%, I think they're going to slow down and back off on continuing their tightening cycle, and economic growth really slows to a very modest rate.
Where does this leave the business landscape? I've heard you mention wage pressures. I've heard you mention labor shortages. We're headed for this economic contraction. There's going to be this reduced demand, I've also heard you say. Where does this leave businesses?
Well, at the moment, we have labor shortages from coast to coast, and StatsCan's last data showed that there was around 1 million unfilled jobs in Canada, and this was an astonishing number. We've never had 1 million unfilled positions in this country, and that actually is equal to the number of unemployed workers in Canada. But of course, those unemployed workers don't necessarily have the skills for the unfilled jobs, and those workers aren't necessarily located in the geography where the unfilled jobs are located. And there's always some frictional unemployment, right? There's always people that have just entered the labor market. They've just graduated from school, and so they're just starting to look for work. So we have very acute labor shortages in the country. And so I think even as economic growth slows, I think the labor market's going to remain tight. And this is another reason why I think we are more likely to have a period of stagflation than we are to have a recession, because I think we're going to see wage pressures remain in place. I think this is going to be a challenge for businesses. I think that labor demand is going to remain strong. And if jobs are still, even as economic growth slows, if jobs remain plentiful and wages are rising, that's going to provide some support to the consumer. But at the same time, from a business point of view, if labor is becoming more expensive, it's going to provide a very strong incentive for businesses to think about investing in labor-saving machinery and equipment. So, personally, it's going to be a challenge for businesses that they can't find enough workers. But having, if I'd be happy to see more Canadians get higher wages, particularly if it actually incents businesses to make larger investments in productivity and efficiency enhancing equipment and capital, because Canada has underinvested in machinery and equipment for decades. And if we finally get a situation where labor is becoming more expensive, and that means workers are getting paid more, that's good for workers. But at the same time, if it actually encourages businesses to invest more, it could actually boost Canadian competitiveness in the long run, right? So it's a challenge, no question about it, but there's actually a silver lining to it.
You've essentially broken down recession versus stagflation. How long do you suspect we'll be in this period?
Well, I think that if what we get is a slowdown in growth, but no contraction in the economy, I think that it'll probably take until early part of 2025 for inflation to get back to the Bank of Canada's 2% midpoint target of 2%. So in other words, we're likely to see the peak in inflation sometime this summer. And so we're going to see inflation peak somewhere, you know, if, you know, above 7%. And then I think we're probably going to see over time after the summer, it's going to start to come down, but I think it's going to remain elevated for quite some time. So I think the high cost of living in Canada is going to continue to be a challenge over 2023, 2024, and only gradually will it come down as we end up with slower economic growth. And that would be a stagflationary story. If, on the other hand, central banks are very heavy-handed and they boost interest rates quite hard, and this actually leads to an economic contraction, this is an outcome we don't want. But what it does do is it causes the economy to go into a very sharp decline, but that sharp decline deals with inflation very quickly. Because what happens during a recession is demand falls very fast. And when you get a recession, you get a big contraction in you'll get a contraction in consumer spending. You know, consumers will stop buying. And when consumers stop buying, businesses will not only stop raising prices, many businesses will start thinking about, how do I cut prices to get sales back? And so very quickly, you will get a shift in inflation. And so if we want inflation to go away very, very quickly, one way to do that is to have a recession. So from a business point of view, I really think it, and from a financial market point of view, we really need to think about this in terms of two different scenarios, right? There's one scenario which is more protracted and drawn out, which is a stagflation scenario where we avoid the boom bust cycle, but it takes us longer to get out of this inflation environment. And then the other scenario is the boom bust cycle, where we end up with higher interest rates, a sharp decline in the economy, and then at the same time, the inflation problem disappears very quickly over a period of a few quarters, right? And so this, you know, there's trade-offs here between the two different scenarios. And if I was, you know, from a point of view of planning a business, I would think about the contingencies for both.